I was associated with the incubation activities and entrepreneurship initiative of IIT Bombay right from early days. But of course, after Professor Phatak initiated the pilot here. So when we were moving from pilot to the establishment of a formal center for incubation and entrepreneurship, I was associated at that time. And I was responsible for creating some of the initial policies and procedures. And also, I think my experience went a little further than that. Since I was involved with SIGN, as some people say, the entrepreneurship bug bit me, and I have now my own company. So I can tell you my own journey of last 2-3 years, how it has progressed, what are the challenges that one faces, right? How much an incubator helps, and how much you are still on your own to take your struggles and your company to some level. So I can share you those share with you those experiences. So to begin with, okay, this is the broad outline. I'll just briefly talk about the initiative. I think just repeat maybe some of the points that you might have already gone through. I'll then talk about the incubation facilities and the kind of policies and procedures we tried to set up. What was the objective of those policies? What exactly did we want to achieve? And then conclude with my own experiences and challenges that I see in any incubation activities. I understand that your interest as a part of this workshop is to set up similar facilities, right? Not to become an entrepreneur yourself. Right. Because that makes a big difference on which side of the table you want to be, right? Whether you are setting up infrastructure and facilities and policies, or I think it's important to be on both sides to really understand what an entrepreneur needs, what are his, challenges, and to what extent an incubator can really meet them and address them. And to what extent you should leave them alone. Right? I think that also is an important issue. The context is that IIT Bombay is a large institute. We have 400 plus faculty. In fact, we are a postgraduate and research institute really, with more than 1,000 PhD students and more than 1,500 master students who do a lot of R&D activities. So there is a lot of innovative work being done here. It's a part of our postgraduate studies, and a lot of research gets done. How much of this research, of course, much of it is new, but how much of it is innovative and ready for entrepreneurship is a different issue. We all are required to do research, publish, and have something new and interesting in our work. And there is a large workforce or number of people who are involved in this. IIT Bombay always wanted to share this innovative work with the industry. And there is a Dean of Research and Development's office, which is our interface to the industrial world. And through this channel, we try to share our expertise and skills with the industry. And there are mechanisms by which what we do can be transferred to the industry, right? Ultimately, what you do must be useful. And one way of directly being useful is to share it with the industry. And there are well-defined policies now by which we can transfer these technologies to the industry, right? Now, when you discuss this issue of transfer, naturally, the one who developed the technology has to also have some benefit. And these benefits have been defined by institute, and this is a fairly well established setup at the institute, and that is done through Dean R&D's office. Now, if you want to further encourage your faculty and students to take their research on their own to the market, you need to really address a few more issues. And foundation for this was laid by IIT while trying to define its intellectual policies. I think the first step towards entrepreneurship coming out of educational and research institute is to have a very clearly defined intellectual property. And this was done This encouraged the faculty and the students to understand the innovations that they are doing, and if they are, you know, in a position to take it to the next level, to the market, then IIT Bombay made it available to them. So intellectual property, there are a number of issues that need to be addressed here. So I think what any institute, if it is planning to take up this activity, I think the first step would be to clearly define the intellectual policy property, because as an employee of IIT, whatever work I do, naturally the intellectual property is with the institute. Although I am author of that work, the ownership is always with the institute, and the ownership has to be handed over to me in order for me to convert it into a enterprise. So this has been defined. Naturally, when it is handed over to me for entrepreneurship, IIT would expect to gain something out of it. So you need to define this as a part of your policies and procedures. So once this was there, and a parallel thing that happened at that time, which Professor Fatak must have shared with you, is the pilot incubator which was set up at the time when information technology was at its peak, and most of the initiatives used to be in the dot-coms, right? Everybody had an idea to share with the public, and therefore everybody was trying to set up a, you know, internet-based company. Basically, the policy defines how the work that has been done by an individual, right, can be shared, and what would be the basis of that sharing. And it has to address many aspects of this, because things can be quite complicated. The work may be done by me alone, or it may be done by me and my students. It may be done as a part of my employment at IIT. It may be done as a part of research funding from the government, or it may be also done based on some consultancy work that I do with the industry. All of this has to be defined. A proper sharing policy has to be put in place. Right. So, share, I mean, basically, it's a matter of numbers. Right. You need to define. So, for example, IIT's policies are very generous. So, if I do consultancy or I want to do technology transfer based on my work, you know, IIT has a sort of 30-70 kind of a sharing policy, which is, I think, fairly, you know, it's in the favor of the author and encourages him to do work which is practical and useful, and also get associated with the industry. So it's a very open and flexible kind of a policy, but naturally there are processes through which this has to be clearly identified.
IP stands for
Okay, now IP has to be first clearly understood. IP is a policy on which, you know, which has been clearly the work which is protected naturally has to be part of some patent or some such thing, right? And IIT has policies for patenting. Now, work may not also be patented, because patenting has a cost. So I may do a work which gets published, and once you publish it, naturally only copyright you have, but the work itself is in public domain. So in this case, what are the issues involved in taking it further for entrepreneurship? So all those also have been identified and defined.
What the author will give the institute, that I would like to have.
See, no, institute has everything. Institute is the owner, whereas I am the author. Now, question is, as far as I am the author and there is no other user, it remains as the ownership of the institute. Only when there is somebody who wants to use it, comes the issue of sharing whatever benefit we receive from that work. And that benefit is shared in the 30-70%. Right? So I think this was the first milestone in moving towards, you know, and encouraging people to look at entrepreneurship as an alternative, right? As a career path. Then there was a...
there are some organizations like NCL, these kind of things are
there. Yeah, I think NCL also probably has all these policies in place. So that is first step. Then of course there are more things that need to be done, because when I get into entrepreneurship, I need something more, not just the idea. Right. Huh. So we'll come to that a little later. But I think the point is that I am an individual who is employed in this institute. The work that I do is in this context, I need to have ownership of that in order to build an organization or a product and then sell it in the market. So I need IIT's permission, and that permission comes under the context of this IP policy. Okay, so at this point then the other track which was very important and which happened at this institute was the pilot incubator that you have already been introduced. This just places the whole thing in the context of, you know, end to end, that work that you do, how does it find use, right? So as you can see that an institute primarily is engaged in research and development. You demonstrate that technology to your industry partners, you develop prototypes and demonstrate its usefulness. But beyond that, it becomes more focused towards industry and entrepreneurship, right? And you need to set up the production or manufacturing of that, you need to market it, right? And then there has to be a buyer who will find value in what you have done. So this is the whole spectrum, and you need to keep this in mind in order to understand the challenges of entrepreneurship, right? So it's, we educational institutes are generally towards one end, right? And we are you know, engaged in R&D activities, and there are aspects of industry and manufacturing and marketing which generally we are not aware. And in order to make a successful company, we really need to understand the whole spectrum of these activities for the success of any organization. So we are at the one end, we really need to reach to the other end. What needs to be done? What are the industries, what the industries do, what is their focus is sort of brought out in trying to understand how a research is taken to the end user. And you can see that technology transfer is one way of achieving this, right? That is where IIT will talk to the industry and will share the research and maybe get a one-time consideration for that. Right? Or of course, it could be also some kind of a royalty also is possible. So we have two ways by which we can join hands with the industry. One is doing outright technology transfer. The other is to enter in some kind of a long-term revenue sharing or some kind of a royalty, so that the industry can exploit the research and you know, research work that has been done in the institute. Now this may be replaced then by an entrepreneur. You know, the faculty himself may set up a company who wants to do that, and therefore there will be a technology transfer, and that company will have to undertake manufacturing, marketing and so on. With this pilot in place, which actually inspired many of our students to look at this option, and also some of the faculty, we wanted to clearly understand what are the challenges, right? And these challenges are related to the risk associated in starting anything new. So what are the barriers to a new venture creation? And we need to understand this so that we can facilitate and reduce the risks associated with new ventures. So incubation facility, the goal of that facility naturally would be to remove these barriers. So one of the barrier is naturally that, you know, there are opportunities in the market today. Should I really take up a job or should I get into entrepreneurship? This is a choice that has to be made by individuals. Especially our students are always, this is one of the first decisions that they need to make. They might end up doing good work, but whether they want to carry it forward with entrepreneurship or to take up a job. Naturally, this is an aspect of risk. So if I can minimize those risks and help them, then they might be more entrepreneurship oriented than let's say a job oriented kind of a professional. There is also an issue of high upfront investment. Therefore, we need some kind of a financial help that we can provide to them. Generally, there are not too many role models. So we need to have some kind of mentorship in place so that we can minimize the risk of failures. Because these are young people or people who are not exposed to business world or in the market, and we need to give them adequate mentorship so that the risk of failure can be reduced or minimized. We have to also educate people about how to, what are the rules, regulations in starting new companies, right? What are the government policies? What are the licenses required? What kind of, as you are aware, there are company laws. Those company laws, many of us in the academic world are simply not familiar, right? And they look very difficult. So we need to create resources or what is referred here as ecosystem by which this load can be reduced from the new entrepreneurs. In fact, this is quite an issue because I have gone through this in the last 2 years, and there are so many rules and so many filings that you have to make that if you do not, you may not even be aware, and you might really make mistakes which might lead to some penalty because you have not been following the rules and regulations. So you need to provide this support. So this is the same story that you have heard before, that we had a pilot incubator and we had a small infrastructure which was created to support. So what exactly did this pilot demonstrate in terms of the barriers that we had mentioned earlier? It allowed people to walk in with an idea, and they gave the initial support and resources which was needed by them in order to start their company. There was an equity-based consideration. That means the incubator gave the facilities on the basis of sharing the equity, right? Instead of explicitly charging, because the new ventures do not really have much cash in hand. The only thing that they really come to you with is the equity, and they can offer you that equity for whatever services and facilities that they need. So this was an ad hoc kind of a equity based model. In fact, that time we did not even know who will hold this equity, who owns that equity, because there was no rules and policies in place, right? The initial companies just agreed to give the equity, but in fact from our side we were not ready to take that equity. The whole thing was quite informal, but it actually educated us in terms of what was required in order to formalize this model, in order to take it to the institute level from a pilot. So pilot, we regarded it as quite a successful story, and there were a number of experiences that we got from this which helped us to move forward. Okay. This also created a lot of excitement within the institute, because this came to be known as another option to the faculty and the students. And if you see that time, there were a number of new success stories, like the IT, especially in the IT domain with Infosys and others. So they became the role models for the students, and everybody was excited with what was happening in that domain. And also there was a low entry barrier as far as the IT companies were concerned, right? It was also easier to set up the facilities. What you really needed was to give a few systems and a place, and the people could start the company and at least work towards creating a prototype and a product. So the barrier to the initial work that is required in entrepreneurship was very low, and that is what the pilot could provide. Then with the success of this, the institute then decided to see whether we can make a separate initiative out of this, which is available to all the departments, not just confined to the IT domain, but also is available to the other engineering faculties. So for this, we need to formalize the policies and procedures, and also try to understand the institute commitments which are necessary in order to formalize this. The first and the most important was really the consideration model. Since the intellectual property is owned by the institute and that is to be transferred, it is not possible to expect one-time charges from young entrepreneurs. So the only successful model all over the world is to really have an equity-based model, which means that when you transfer the technology developed within the institute and on which the institute has an intellectual property rights, you would like to give this away for an equity consideration. So naturally then the question comes, who can hold the equity? And since IIT as a government institute is not permitted to hold equity, we decided to create a separate society, which is really a society set up by what we call friends of IIT. Basically, these are alumni and our ex-students and some office bearers of the institute who created this, as it is called, Section 25 company in the country, which is really a society which is a non-profit kind of a organization. And this is an umbrella organization which would own that incubator and which would hold the equity on behalf of IIT. This was the model that we thought of. So SAIN was set up as an independent legal entity, although the office bearers and the board will be really mainly drawn from the institute, because the institute policies will have to be implemented and the institute will like to oversee the functioning of this society. So it has a functional autonomy, it has its own governing board, and it has a specific mandate to set up a business incubator and to help these organizations which are incubated there to build successful companies. Initial funding from IIT came in the form of space, infrastructure and so on. Right? And also at the same time, Government of India through Department of Science and Technology had taken up a initiative called Technology Development Board. And TDB also wanted to get associated with this initiative. And they also agreed to share some of the funds for the initial setting up of the incubator. There was a funding from alumni also. And we wanted to start off this initiative by creating a big awareness within the campus. Because once you have an incubator, you need to have a steady flow of applications for starting new companies. So on day one, this may not happen, and you need to create an awareness, and you have to tell people that not every research that you do is a candidate for incubation and entrepreneurship. Therefore, you need to consider the utility of your research in the ongoing or the state of art kind of a industrial context. So we thought of doing some pre-incubation and regular incubation and also some virtual incubation. The virtual incubation was primarily limited to companies which need infrastructure which is not possible to provide in the IITs or science facilities, right? Because ultimately, let's say if you have an idea coming from chemical or metallurgy or something, naturally you cannot give them infrastructure which may be needed for their incubation. So virtual incubation helped us in two ways. One is the companies for which the office kind of infrastructure is not the main requirement, but they really need something much more than just the office premises. And also, because we had limited facilities, we thought that we could admit more than what our facilities could hold through the concept of virtual incubation. So there were a few companies that we tried to put in this category. Yeah.
Can you talk a little more about what you do offer through virtual incubation, like if it's not office space, what is it?
Right. Since there is no specific space given to them, but they are still registered as science companies, and therefore they will have access to not just the office facilities, the regular office facilities, but all the mentoring and other legal support that IIT, that the SAIN can provide. So help in registering their companies, help in maintaining their accounts, etc. Even with virtual incubation, there would be some equity that IIT will take because of the intellectual property that might have been transferred. In fact, we clearly try to define the scope for sharing this equity. The equity agreement is not only covering the intellectual property, but it is also covering the infrastructure and the branding that happens through IIT and the network that IIT Bombay will make accessible to the incubating company, right? Through its alumni network, through its industrial network, and also the support that the institute's infrastructure can provide, because we have large number of research labs available on the campus, faculty who are expert in various areas, and also the library support. So all these are also a part of the environment which we share with the incubating companies. Therefore, there are three dimensions which are covered by our equity agreement: the intellectual property, the infrastructure, and also the IIT's brand and access to the IIT's network, the industry network and the alumni network. So even in the case of virtual incubation, what is really missing is the physical infrastructure, but the rest is still in place, and therefore they are the companies which are under the IIT's broad policies of incubation.
The thing is, signed versus other incubation, like any differences, any contradictions, any different way of looking at signed incubator versus other incubators? If you have any experience, that'll be wonderful if you can share it with you.
Right. We'll talk about some other models, but you know, I'm talking about sign as a model of a typical government organization which is sharing the intellectual property generated within the educational and research activities, right? But there are definitely other models. But the one which I just probably can mention right away is incubators being set up by industrial associations, right? CII, for example, the Confederation of Indian Industries, may actually create an infrastructure. Basically, see, all incubations are trying to facilitate the new entrepreneurship. Some of the things that they may do is to first give the infrastructure. The second is to help you in marketing and business development. And third, they may actually make some funds available. So these are number of things that any incubator can do. What an incubator in IIT can do and what an incubator under Confederation of Industries can do will depend on resources available to them. Right? For example, some VCs are setting up incubator. Like say in Bangalore, there are few who are saying that let's set up our own incubators, let us receive applications, we'll create a small infrastructure, right, and we'll mentor them. And maybe on day one, we'll also provide them some funds. Again, this will be done based on some equity consideration, right? So overall, I think there may be some few constraints which are missing in different contexts. For example, ability to hold equity, this constraint will not be there for others, whereas it is a constraint at IIT, right? Because we cannot take profits out of sign into IIT, that will be another constraint. Whereas these constraints may not be applicable to a VC-funded incubator, or it may not be available to, or it may not be applicable to industry-funded incubator. But I think when you talk of an incubator, you have to consider these three requirements of any incubating company. A company needs funds, company needs space and infrastructure, and company needs some hand-holding. So can you provide these under whatever umbrella that you can define? So we tried to institutionalize what was learnt in our pilot experience. When we are moving from pilot to formalizing this at the institute level, we naturally needed policies and procedures. And before defining, you need to also understand the scope of your business incubator you want to put up. First thing that we realized was to first, in trying to define the scope, the exercise that we undertook was to define the vision and mission for our business incubator, because that puts in place, you know, what are your short-term and long-term goals and what can be achieved, right? So we spent considerable amount of time with some of our leading alumni who have been very successful business people in trying to define the vision and mission. So for example, is social entrepreneurship to be included? Are you focusing only on successful entrepreneurship, or you want to encourage people to be entrepreneur, You don't want to worry too much about they being successful or not successful. So I think some of these goals have to be clearly defined before you can really define the policies and procedures in details. So for example, should the business incubator be profitable? Right? Or you just want to have it as a support facility? Should it be proactively creating the infrastructures and the mentorship and legal other supports, or it should be on a demand basis? What kind of monitoring you would do? All those things need to be clearly understood before you can develop these procedures and policies in details. You need to understand the constraints. Would you be funding these people, or would you just provide space? What are the regulations within the institute? Let's say, so if I am a faculty and I am setting up my entrepreneurship, how much time can I give, right? And what would be my consideration? And if my company becomes a very successful company, so is it only related to equity, or there is something more? All those things have to be clearly defined. So we try to understand these issues, because many of the initial proposals came from faculty, and naturally they have other responsibilities. So how much time can they really devote to such activities has to be clearly worked out. And understand the areas in which you want to give support to them. So science vision and mission was set up. I suppose you have probably seen this already. So we want to create an environment to translate the knowledge and innovation that is generated within the institute. So we don't really want to become a facility which can be, you know, shared with outside also, and who can come here and set up their companies here. But it has to be rooted within the institute, right? And our mission clearly said that we want to support innovation and knowledge-based entrepreneurship, right, in the IIT Bombay community. Specific that our goal is to serve IIT Bombay community through this. And creating wealth is not the only goal, but also social value. So this was also part of our mission. Of course, you know, it's simple to say, right? But what exactly does it mean when I say that, let's say, creation of social value also is a goal, and how can SIGN facilitate that? Do I do something different for these companies than for the companies whose focus is to be successful economically and financially? Right? So maybe this is a question that you can ask towards the end, when you when SIGN people are here and talk about this. Okay, so this is our broad spectrum model. We said that we have three focus areas. Of course, the economic and wealth creation is a generally understood goal of any business organization. But we said that being a technology institute where a lot of strategic research is also done and useful to the government organizations in R&D and defense and so many services, we thought that we'll also undertake strategic companies which do work in the strategic areas, which will be of importance to the government organizations, with the focus being on technology. So wealth creation is not the focus here, and the social is the third dimension of our incubation model. So we have had companies in all the three cases with different probably levels of success. But we need to also understand the constraints that they face. So for example, why strategic companies cannot generate wealth, right? Or why social companies can also not generate wealth. These are some of the points that we need to understand, and what really distinguishes between these three different categories. So these are broadly our policies, and probably you are familiar with some of these. So we now take proposals only from faculty and our alumni. We had a big debate initially, because during our pilot, lot of companies came from students who were still studying here. So one of the issues that we had to resolve immediately was, can you have a company when you are still studying? And can you really do a justice to both your academic commitments and to your organization? So I still remember a class when I used to have a couple of CEOs and CTOs in my class, right? And they were still in third year. And it was very hard to ensure that they are not defocusing themselves from studies. They were naturally good students. And later on, when I became dean of academic programs, this was the first issue that I needed to address, because I was now looking after not the sign at that time, but I was looking after the academic commitments of the students. So we made a provision, in fact, and also some kind of a policy that if you are a student studying, you cannot have a commitment to a company. Maybe you should take a break then. Take a break and do justice to your entrepreneurship initiative. Come back and do your remaining studies. Okay, the consideration model was an equity model and also a revenue sharing model. In fact, we felt when we started receiving the business proposals from our community, there were different types of projects coming up, and some had time plan of generating revenue and profits which might go over 3 years, 4 years. Some had done the feasibility, but product development was yet to be done fully. So the gestation period before you start earning a revenue and profit could be substantially different from company to company. So do you just have only equity based model, or is it a good idea to do revenue sharing also? So when I was looking after the sign setup, we devised a model which is taking both. We might have a combination of equity and revenue sharing, because there were some proposals which were planning to have a very early revenue, right? And where the promoter may not want to give a large equity to sign. In fact, we have to understand this from the market scenario, what kind of equity you should take. So let's say I mentioned to you 30-70 model. Now, do you really take 30-70 in the equity? That probably no venture will ever succeed if somebody demands a 30% equity on day one. Now, in order to understand how much equity IIT should take, you have to really understand the role of technology in an entrepreneurship activity, or a role of product, or a role of research in an entrepreneurship activity. So what does the research or prototype that I have developed, how much does it contribute towards the success of a company? In fact, this was a very important question to answer in order to arrive at the level of equity that IIT should demand from these companies. Right? Because I am transferring the intellectual property and I need to take equity for that. So should it be 5%, should it be 30%, should it be 15%? And that is where you have to get some market inputs, and you need to talk to market leaders or industry people or even VCs to understand these equations. And what we felt is that the idea itself, the product idea, really does not contribute to a success more than 10 to 15%. Right? There is much more that is needed than just the basic core idea. Right? You will build a product, but then you need to, you need to define the manufacturing environment for that, marketing, sales, etc. These are the other bigger challenges, and therefore, assuming that it is 10% to 15%, we said equity should be 10 into 15% of 30% share that IIT has in any sharing. So since IIT has a 30-70 sharing, and of that 30, the contribution towards success is only 10% of that. Therefore, IIT should take 3 to 4% equity in any company for an IP. So this is what we arrived at. But of course, there are other components that I said before, that besides the intellectual property, you have the infrastructure, you have also the mentoring. So for this, you may take additional equity. So our model worked out equity in the range of 3 to 8%, right? For depending on you know, the how much of support we can provide. And revenue sharing naturally can be looked upon as a way of reducing the equity component. So there were companies who had who imagined that their companies will be highly successful, maybe something like Google or Yahoo in future, and naturally nobody will give you 78% of equity in such companies. So there were people who were willing to share either revenue or investments coming into the company for the equity. So we have actually had cases where we took as little as 1% equity and as high as 8% equity in some of the cases. So duration, how long can it naturally?
How revenue sharing works?
Hmm?
Like through supply.
Revenue means, let's say I have a product ready, right? And I expect that maybe after 1 year, my marketing and sales will be in place. And let's say I'll earn 1 crore revenue, right? In the first year of my operations or second year of my operations. So you take a part of that in place of equity. So I may say that instead of taking 8% equity, I will take say 5% equity and 1% of revenue, right?
Certain number of years.
For certain number of years. Yeah, it's not perpetual. So in most cases, we had restricted revenue sharing for say 2 to 3 years. Okay. So duration we said will be. Okay, we have those, some exit options there. Huh, right. See, that is another problem with any incubator is that I hold equity against the infrastructure. Now, infrastructure has a tangible cost. Equity has no tangible price or value till I find a buyer for that, or there is a trading and I can sell off that equity. So there is always a risk associated, and considering the high failure rates in any new entrepreneurship, you are really taking a risk, okay, in taking equity only. Therefore, we thought that wherever possible, we'll have less equity and more revenue, right? Depending on our assessment of the risk associated with that. But of course, this has to be in discussion with the promoter. This, I think, was a very important point. We needed to arrive at percentages which would appeal to entrepreneurs, right? Who will find it appropriate, you know, for their risks that they themselves are going to take. Because it's, look at it from the entrepreneur's point of view. He has an idea and he comes to you. He is willing to share some equity, but there is still some much more that he needs. He needs, for example, funding. There would be challenges of building his team. On day one, in an environment like IIT, the team you have is really only technical team. You know, on day one, you don't have people with marketing and sales experience or experience in business development. So on day one, actually all teams are or all proposals are weak in that respect, unless they have some tie-up with somebody outside. Right? So you might make a proposal with some people in IIT and some people from external world. These may be alumni or these may be other industry people. So based on this, we make an assessment of the proposal and you decide on the level of equity and revenue sharing. The duration we said should not be more than 3 years in any case, because you must become profitable or you must know where you are going in 3 years. Otherwise, in the comfort of incubator where costs are minimum and you are provided with ready infrastructure, we tend to become, complacent, because your running costs are very low. You know, most of our companies, their burning rate, as we call, is not more than a few lakh rupees a month. In fact, if they have 3-4 people, mostly their own friends, in that case, the salary component is really very small. And therefore, they become comfortable, and the pressures of going out and selling and getting revenue keeps reducing. And in many of the companies, I saw this attitude, which is typical of a lab attitude, you know. So let's keep adding more and more features to the product, or more and more, engineering. And therefore, you keep postponing. In fact, the approach taken outside is exactly opposite of what we do in an incubator, which are coming from educational institute. There, in fact, they will start with the seed marketing. So if you are, let's say, trying to come out with a soap or something, you say, let me buy it from somewhere, or let it get manufactured somewhere else. Let me first create a brand and a market. Whereas here, our approach is, let's build a product, spend time in validating that product, and then, since we all come from an engineering research background, we are tempted by constantly comparing it to 10 products in the market and making it better than them. So this battle never ends, and therefore we need to put some on them to say that you have to get out. 3 years is the maximum time. In fact, first major review happens after 18 months, and there are milestones which are defined. That is a part of our monitoring policy that we have put in place. When we admit somebody, there are a number of agreements which are signed with them, not just the equity agreement, which defines the infrastructure and other thing, but also the facilities agreement, the agreement for tenure in the incubator, and the requirements of constant monitoring and milestones to be achieved are also part of those agreements. Legal relationship, we have these various contractual agreements. We also had some corpus available for giving loans, because this money came from the Department of Science and Technology, and we said we can give some loans to the companies on day one, although there are very few takers for this, because most of us come from middle class families, and loan, we are averse to any loan, and therefore I will rather spend my own limited money or not take salaries and do the development and other thing, because you are generally staying on campus or you have friends on campus, so your day to day requirements are taken care of. These are again some of the comforts which are really not very appropriate or correct in the context of entrepreneurship. And we found that there were very few takers for loans, and although these were almost interest-free loans. Actually, the alumni grant came for the facility which is here available on the top floor, whereas the institute created the infrastructure in a separate building, right? And there was no cash which was given by any alumni or by institute for supporting the companies. It's only in terms of facilities. Yeah. So the loan component was supported primarily through the DST grant.
So it's a repayable grant is paid?
No, in fact, I don't think this is repayable to the DST. Yeah, I think, but you can get more details, because this is expected to become a corpus, and it probably should build further.
Today I was discussing with my registrar about this. I mean, what should be the arrangement for this?
Yeah, right. I think the first, at least the first component was not refundable.
Okay.
Means by the institute need not pay back to the DST, but of course the companies have to pay back, because you want to roll it further.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Okay, then we had benchmarks for graduation and exit. Right, you need to have very clearly defined exit policies. Exit policies not only for the company to exit, but also exits for your equity. Our equity agreement, which probably the sign people will discuss in more details, has all the required considerations. So, for example, if the sign is holding the equity, what are the stages at which it can exit? Right? And exit may be partial, may be complete. It may be when you are profitable, or it may be when some venture funding is coming into the company. So all those are covered in the agreements. So we set up these facilities, and there were some facilities which were given to companies specifically, and some which were shared, like the office infrastructure and so on. We then also had this network of mentors, right? The SIGN has a board, and the board has a distinguished people from the industry and alumni. So this became available for mentoring the various companies. Plus, we also, now answering your question, we also created a network of we have some on the panel, lawyers and accountants who can provide this various services. They have been empaneled by SIGN, and for basic services they are free, but specific services will be on a charge basis, and the company will directly pay these agencies at a predefined rate. But at least all the companies were made aware of the various obligations for forming their companies. Everybody has to form a private limited company, and they have to register with the ROC, Registrar of Companies. You have to have your own CA, and in all the agreements we have defined that they have to submit their annual account statements and so on. So all these are very, we educate every applicant about these requirements. Really, this really didn't materialize. We thought we'll set up a seed fund, and the purpose of the seed fund would be to give some kind of a cash, to the applicants. You need to define how this will be given. It may be given for the equity, right? So I give funds. Fund could be a loan. Right, as mentioned earlier, the fund could be in place of equity. So I give, let's say, I do some valuation and take additional equity and give money to the entrepreneur so that he can carry on his development and business activities. Or it could be an outright grant. Right? In fact, DST has these three mechanisms available. And they gave us the money. It was our decision to use primarily as a loan, because we felt more comfortable with that, right? Because loan is something where you feel it will come back, right? In fact, but that also was the reason that people don't like loan. I would like to take it as an equity. And we found that equity is something which government doesn't understand properly, right? So if they say you are giving 10 lakh rupees loan, then take equity worth 10 lakh. Now that is not possible, because on day one, the company has entire equity of 1 lakh. So naturally, at face value, nobody will give the equity to the government. And valuations are not easy to define, and therefore it was not very easy to fund the companies through the equity route initially. Later on, we had number of meetings with the DST people, and we tried to create a model through which the equity route also became available. And in fact, some companies did receive, including my company, we did receive funding from DST, which was in terms of equity. They took equity, and in order to conclude this, you have to do some kind of a valuation. So you say, my share with face value of rupees 10, at what price will I give it to, let's say, whoever is bringing the money? In fact, most of our companies have got little funds from either angel investors, as we call them, or people who have some money and wants to put in your idea. And SIGN created some kind of a benchmark for valuation in terms of the cost of infrastructure and the cost of services. So for example, if I incubate a company X for 3 years at, let's say, 6% equity stake in them. In 3 years, what is the cost to me to SIGN? Let's say that cost comes out to be, say, 25 lakh rupees. Because ultimately, I am subsidizing a lot. So what is the cost of that subsidy that I offer to the company? So I say, now, if my subsidy costs me 25 lakh rupees for 6% equity, what is the value of your equity? And then we use that as a baseline for valuation. And in fact, DST has taken that in some cases. Right? So, for example, in some cases, a 10 rupee share, because of science participation and science infrastructure, was valued as much as 2000 rupees per share. Right? Because of the equity base being small and things like that. So in some, but that was the basis, that you know, if the, what is the science equity and what is the science cost for supporting the incubator for that time. And based on that, we had a pricing model. And that pricing model was used for taking additional equity through which some money can be made available to the companies. I just wanted to talk about some of the ventures which are there right now. For example, you know, it's actually good to see how they relate to the faculty's work and how faculty proposed companies based on their work. So Gram++, for example, is a product, a GIS product which was developed in CSRE, our department here, and it was done through a government grant. Almost the entire development was done through DST projects. So before they could incubate, naturally they have to, it was an intellectual property shared between IIT and DST. So DST had to give a go ahead. And there was a lot of time taken by DST as well as IIT to sort out the IP related issues. Once the IP related issues were sorted out and the DST allowed the company to build their further product line based on the Gram++ product, they were incubated. And today they are doing, I think, reasonably well. They have a model, they have some further developments, and they have a few customers who are using this product. In fact, this is my own company, which primarily works in the collaboration space, where people can collaborate online with each other in whichever domain. You may be in a research domain or you may be in marketing domain. We all work together and collaborate. So this software allows you to work together, right? And also does all the information management, knowledge management, interaction management, somewhat better, that's what we claim, somewhat better than what the other tools do, right? Now that proof of whether it is really better or not is where the market will test it out. We have been incubating in Sign for 2.5 years. This is what our product does. So you can see that collaboration has number of components, and probably our product is one which handles all the stages of any collaboration, right from creating and collecting information, collaborating and discussing it among your group, and further consolidating it for final sharing and reporting. Okay, so let me skip this. So when I now look back on what I have been doing in Sign, I just said that we have been there for little more than 2 years. We did have some funding from various sources, but funding which allowed us only to work on a shoestring budget level for 2 years. So where are we? And what were the challenges that we were facing? Understanding the market is probably one of the biggest challenges. You are excited by a product. You say, oh, I have a good collaboration product. But really that is the least important when you go out to the market. Where is your market? What do they buy? What are the prices at which level they buy? Right? So all these things are important. How will you reach out to them? How will you position your product? How will you differentiate it with others? Right? What is the team you have? In fact, many of the Sign failures, we did have some problem cases, and many of them were because of a bad team. You don't, one individual cannot do. In fact, the faculty cannot give more than 25% officially, just one day a week. Of course, unofficially, you may give all 7 days. But issue is that one or two people cannot really form a company and make it successful. This is the biggest challenge, getting a right kind of a group which will address all aspects of a company, not just the product development, marketing, sales, technology, and all those aspects. Understand the growth and sustenance challenges. These where the challenges and you know difficulties that any incubator faces, not only at the beginning but even after 2 years, what we are constantly going through as in my company I'm talking about. So we then build this ecosystem further after creating the sign. And we have number of other initiatives that we thought will enhance the incubation activities further. There are number of events that we conduct which make students and faculty aware of these. We are also trying, I was trying that, and we had met a few individuals to create a separate seed fund, not under the government or DST umbrella, but something which will have you know more flexible rules. And we had talked to State Bank, for example, and it was almost set up, but there are a number of again rules and procedures which come in the way, government rules. So let's say you want to create a seed fund which will invest in these companies. Should it be registered with SEBI? You know, because SEBI is an organization which handles all equity related investments. So it really needed a lot of work both on our side and on the State Bank side to get the picture clear whether to go ahead with creating that kind of a seed fund. Then there are other legal issues. Should it be under some trust? Will SIGN manage it? Will SBI manage it? You know, number of these problems do come up. We did create a panel of mentors. We invited a number of industry experts to take up mentorship of these companies to tell them what are the strategic issues that they need to address, not just the product focus, but how to grow beyond certain point. And we asked these people to take up certain specific companies of their interest and have a one-to-one kind of a mentorship over a long period of time. And that did happen in some cases very fruitfully. Yes, we have a model. In fact, we defined a model for mentorship, again, in terms of equity. And we said that let the mentor commit a certain fixed time per month, and let's also define the role he will play and the value he will bring. And then we said we can have some kind of an equity model, let's say something like 0.5% for 6 months or some such thing. Right? So that model was quite helpful because if SIGN defines it, everybody doesn't have to negotiate it again and again. Right? So that was a good thing, and therefore we could straight away approach them. Again, IIT's name helped us because we are well networked and we have a lot of alumni, and they felt that they can add a lot of value through this. So this was quite successful actually, and I hope SIGN will continue doing it further. Yeah.
And the relationships that 0.5%, it came out of SIGN's percentage, or this was additional that came that the entrepreneurs gave to the mentors?
The entrepreneurs gave. No, it did not come out from SIGN's equity. It has to be from the entrepreneurs' equity. In addition.
And the standard sort of relationship, what SIGN defined was just a time commitment, or did SIGN also define sort of very specific?
It gave some guidelines. It gave some guidelines, right? These guidelines could be for very specific type of activity, and it could be in terms of specific commitment. Because some people might be able to give me a day a week, but there are some senior other people who may not be able to give more than a half a day a month, and they might come and attend only board meetings, and they might help you only at strategic level or at networking you with another industry player where you can probably do a pilot of your product and things like that. So they brought value from that sense. So the percentages were defined and the time was defined only as a model. And you need to fine-tune it on a case-by-case basis. But you had a model to start with. That was a good thing.
Broker-type fees with either mentors or other people who were able to set up deals with investors, things like that?
I didn't get the question.
Broker fees, like if somebody was able to fix a deal or fix a meeting with a VC or an angel who put money in, did did that person end up taking some percentage?
Actually, I don't think such cases have happened. So basically what you're saying is, let's say I have a mentor and he helps me in getting a VC funding. I'm not aware, but I think probably again it would be case by case basis. But it's definitely not part of the science model. And then we have some formal, I think, NEN under which this workshop is being conducted, and we have relationships with Thai and so on. So these are again very helpful kind of association that SIGN has for facilitating entrepreneurship. Okay, pre-incubation was something we thought. See, people were excited with entrepreneurship idea. So I have a project in which my student has done something, I have done something. They want to apply to the SIGN for incubation. But they do not have all the data which is necessary. See, first, they have to do market survey. They have to understand the state of art in the market today with respect to that segment. They have to also work out some kind of business plan. They may also need to develop their product further. So in order to help them in doing all this, we created a pre-incubation initiative where SIGN will act as a mentor to the faculty or the student to further enhance their idea or to collect the required data so that a good business plan can be made. So it can be, let's say, some little bit of funding that SIGN may give, let's say 2 lakh rupees to me, through which I may hire one programmer or somebody who will further develop it and bring to a stage where I can do better feasibility and better, you know, evaluation of that. Or it could be somebody who will do a simple research for, say, copyright or patenting purpose. Is there something already there? Or who will go to the market and do some background study? It was simply to facilitate the person's position with respect to his readiness for applying to SIGN. So we tried. I don't think we had too many there because I think the institute already has enough research and other facilities through which these things can be done. Right? So for example, I can get enough number of master's students, PhD students, and many of us have research grants through which I can essentially do what we were planning to do through pre-incubation. But we thought it might be useful to students. I think one or two student groups were helped because they don't have access to resources, and we thought we could support them and bring them to a stage where their idea can be considered for incubation. Oh yes, in fact, there can be dropout. In fact, that also, see, dropout is not a bad idea. At least I know that I should not go further, right, and not waste time. Right?
We're not wasting the society's resource.
So, in a way, that helps the candidate.
Yes, it does help. That's why even our restriction of 2 to 3 years and asking them to do early exit is also beneficial both to entrepreneur and to the incubator. Right? So, if something is not going anywhere, it's better to stop that and look at other alternatives.
The faculty incubating companies, do you have any different or same rules?
Same rules. There are no different rules for, let's say, equity model or any such thing. In fact, there is really, we don't distinguish from where the application has come. Yes, student can apply for a leave and it can be granted. Postgraduate is anyway very short duration, 2-year program. And PhD students rarely think of entrepreneurship, right? They are very focused on their research work. So it's really the undergraduate students who get excited by this. And in fact, most of our proposals have come from undergraduate students, you know. I think nowadays, of course, there are hardly any proposals from students who are studying. Earlier, we had some proposals, and then we had some difficulties also. Therefore, that framework was put up, and either you take a break or you do it after finishing your studies. So I think that has become quite well accepted now.
And the faculty
We have that facility also. So we have now a sabbatical that we give also for incubation. Usually you have a sabbatical once in 6 years, right, based on your just service. Now we said that you can now have a sabbatical based on your entrepreneurship, and which can come anytime, right? So in the bucket of 6 years, I used to take it after 6 years. Now I can take it anytime, right? And that because I cannot wait for 6 years to get over till I do my entrepreneurship. So we permitted that. We actually changed our policy at the institute level to encourage people to take sabbatical for this.
And during that period, practically he's on the payroll of the institute.
Yeah, sabbatical has its own rules. Yeah. So you get full pay.
Okay.
Okay, thank you very much.